The papacy as anti-Messiah. Father, we just ask you to open our eyes and our ears and our hearts that we may see and hear and understand the truth from your word, the things that you're trying to show us. And we thank you, Father, for Brother Norman Willis, who's allowed us to read this book. Father, let us glean from the research that he has done in this book. And we thank you for hearing our prayer, Father. We just ask you to give us a direct path to truth. And through this research in Yahushua's name, we thank you for hearing our prayer. Amen. The papacy is anti-Messiah. This will be expanded to show the ties between the Catholic Church and Islam in the fourth edition. I believe this is the fourth edition here on Kindle. This is also discussed in some detail in Revelation and the End Times. Before Christianity was adopted as the official religion of the Roman Empire, the previous religion was known as Mithraism. Mithraism is sun worship, and in Mithraism, the sun deity Ra was thought to personally attend the Roman emperor. That the Roman citizens believed their deity would sit in personal attendance to the Roman emperor gave him unparalleled power and prestige in their eyes. To disobey the decree of such a demi-deity was not only considered treason, but almost heresy. As opposed to the Nazarene faith, Mithraism was not Torah-based. The Torah teaches that it is idolatrous to worship men, and idolatry is therefore prohibited by the jealous Elohim. For this reason, the Roman emperors did little to disguise their ill feelings toward the Nazarenes. By teaching the people that the emperors were not demi-deities, the Nazarenes had weakened the emperor's basis of prestige and power. No politician likes that. The Roman emperors also initially despised the Christians for similar reasons. Christianity also taught that one's truest allegiance should not go to Caesar, but to Yahushua, the King of Kings. This also weakened the emperor's power structure, but there was a way for a clever emperor to turn this to his advantage. Because Christianity is not based on Torah, if scripture could be misconstrued to suggest that the emperor was divine, then Constantine could adopt Christianity as his official religion and continue to teach the people to worship him as a demi-deity. History records for us that the Roman emperor Constantine was raised a sun worshiper in 312 Common Era while he was in the grove of the sun deity Apollo in Gaul, ancient France. Constantine claimed to have received a dream in which the Messiah appeared to him, instructing him to write the first two letters of his name, XP, upon his troops' shields. Then the next day he claimed to have seen a cross superimposed over the sun, at which time he was given the message, "In this sign you will be victorious, in hoc signo vinces." The next year Constantine and his co-emperor issued the Edict of Milan, a document formally ending the persecution of Christians within the Roman Empire. Constantine then continued to battle with others for supremacy over the empire, and he did in fact emerge victorious by the year 324 Common Era. We should note, however, that even though he officially converted to Christianity, Emperor Constantine still reverenced the sun. His belief in Christianity was inextricably merged with his belief in sun worship, and he continued to live his life by sun worship constructs. He continued to wage war for personal advantage, continued to rest on the sun day in honor of the sun deity, and even minted coins to the Roman sun deity Sol Invictus Mithra. It is also reported that he had his wife and son beheaded, even though he considered himself to be a Christian. About the same time he established himself as the undisputed ruler of the Roman Empire, Constantine convened the Council of Nicaea. This council blended Christianity and Mithraism, establishing the new Catholic, universal, Christian faith. This new faith took the same core of familiar Mithraic festivals, but renamed them according to Christian themes. This was done to such an extent that the accusation has been made that Catholicism, or Universalism, is really more Mithraism in disguise than anything else. While Constantine allowed the official version of Christianity to be practiced within his empire, it should also be noted that the Catholic Church condemned Nazarenes as heretics in that they continued to keep the Torah as the apostles had. And this is from the Church of Imperial Rome, Council of Laodicea under the Emperor Constantine, the Canon 29, at 336 A.D., Christians must not Judaize by resting on the Sabbath, but must work on that day, honoring rather the Lord's Day, Sunday, by resting, if possible, as Christians. However, if any Nazarene be found Judaizing, let them be shut out from the Messiah. Other translations read, let them be anathema to the Messiah, insinuating that the Nazarenes were to be considered the ultimate personae non grata. Thus, those who were willing to adopt Mithraic traditions would become safe from the lions in the arena, but the Nazarenes never became so. Shut out of the synagogues in the first century by the Jews and now thrown to the lions by the papacy in the fourth, the Nazarene faith eventually died out. Its adherents either yielded to Roman persecution or were killed by the gladiators for sport. Thus, while the Christian church would fulfill a prophetic role in helping to spread the good news of Yahushua to the ends of the earth, it would also serve as the means by which the faith, once delivered to the saints, would be snuffed out for 2,000 years. It was simultaneously a blessing to the world and a stumbling block to the faithful. Most historians acknowledge that Constantine's motives in blending Mithraism with Christianity had more to do with power politics than anything else. Caesar was, above all, a politician. If he had simply converted to Christianity as it existed before he co-opted it, he would not have been able to continue to pretend that he was a demi-deity. Had that happened, his degree of power and control over his empire would have diminished very rapidly. If Emperor Constantine was to remain the most powerful man on the planet, he would have to find some way of reforming Christianity around Mithraism so that he might continue to appear an all-powerful demi-deity. His means of doing this was to take certain verses in the New Covenant, and that's the Renewed Covenant, and twist them to make it appear as if they said things they actually did not. If one forbids the people to read or interpret the scriptures for themselves, as the Catholics historically did, then one can suggest that certain verses say whatever it is that one needs them to say. What Emperor Constantine needed these verses to say, then, was that he was not just an ordinary mortal. Here is the passage the Catholics use to suggest that the emperor was a demi-deity. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Shimon Kepha, who we know as Simon Peter, answered and said, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living Elohim." Yahushua answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Yona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Kepha," we know him as Peter, "and on this rock," or Petra, "I will build my assembly, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." That's Matit Yahu, or Matthew 16:15-19. There are several issues which will be discussed in later chapters. The key issue at the moment is that the Catholics tell us that this passage indicates the Roman emperor was more than just an ordinary mortal man. Verse 18, "And I also say to you that you are Peter," or Petros, "and on this rock," the Petra, "I will build my assembly, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it." The Catholic Church asserts that Yahushua intended to build his assembly upon an individual named Shimon Kepha personally. Therefore, whomever Shimon Kepha, or Simon Peter as we know him, would designate as his successor would become the head of the body of the Messiah, as if the Messiah ruled through him. There are several issues which will be discussed in later chapters. The key issue at the moment is that the Catholics tell us that this passage indicates the Roman emperor was more than just an ordinary mortal man. And I also say to you that you are Peter, Petros, and on this rock, Petra, I will build my assembly, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. The Catholic Church asserts that Yahushua intended to build his assembly upon an individual named Shimon Kepha. Personally, therefore, whomever Shimon Kepha or Simon Peter would designate as his successor would become the head of the body of Messiah, as if the Messiah ruled through him. One problem with this assertion is that Petros and Petra are not the same word. Yahushua does not say he will build his assembly upon Petros or Kepha. Rather, what he said was that he would build his assembly upon the divine revelation that he was the Messiah, the Son of the living Elohim. That divine revelation is the this of verse 17. Yahushua answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Yonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this revelation knowledge to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Moreover, most English translations give an inaccurate rendering of verse 19, "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." This inaccurate rendering seems to suggest that Kepha was in fact some sort of larger-than-life demi-deity. However, when we take this passage back to the Greek text that the Roman Church asserts is the original, what it actually says is that the apostles would bind what had already been bound in heaven. "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will already have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will already have been loosed in heaven." Rather than suggesting that Kepha was some larger-than-life demi-deity, consistent with the Greco-Roman theology, what it says is that by surrendering to the leading of the Spirit, Kepha and the other apostles became tools in the Master's hand. The Roman emperor, however, saw his opportunity to lay claim to continuing demi-deity status, and he took it. The official Roman dogma became that this verse implies a so-called apostolic succession. This doctrine of alleged apostolic succession says that just before his death, Kepha allegedly passed his supernatural powers to his alleged designee, Clement, who then transferred them to the next alleged designee, and etc., to Emperor Constantine, and right on up to the modern day. The Church justifies their assertion that the so-called apostolic succession was indeed passed to Clement because Clement was indeed a disciple. Philippians 4:3, "And I urge you also, true companion, help these women who labored with me in the good news with Clement also, and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life." We also know from Clement's writings that he later became the first bishop of the Church of Rome. Catholic legend maintains that when Kepha was taken to Rome to be crucified, that before he was killed, he laid hands on Clement, thereby designating him as the alleged receiver of the so-called apostolic succession. Legend holds that the baton had allegedly been passed, but this legend is highly problematic. First, Matthew 16 does not speak of an apostolic succession. Second, Scripture indicates that it was actually Jacob, as we know him as James, who was Yahushua's half-brother, who was originally designated head of the Jerusalem assembly. That headship was passed to Kepha after Jacob's death is not proven anywhere. Third, if headship had been given to Kepha, why would he have transferred it next to the capital city of the empire that had long subjugated Judea and had chosen to destroy both Jerusalem and the temple? Why would he transfer headship to the capital of the empire that had crucified Yahushua and would soon crucify him? It would seem a most unlikely choice. Fourth, when we read Clement's epistles, we see something very odd, which can perhaps only be described in political terms. A careful read of the New Covenant, the Renewed Covenant, shows us that even though the apostles had learned directly from Yahushua, I mean, I had to stop for a moment, guys. The page sort of jumped a couple pages. A careful read of the New Covenant shows us that even though the apostles had learned directly from Yahushua, they continued to maintain a generally humble attitude. Even Kepha, who had allegedly been handed the so-called apostolic succession, continued to address his fellow believers as little more than fellow bondservants, emphasizing that they too had been called to serve. Shimon Kepha, a bondservant and apostle of Yahushua Messiah, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our Elohim and Savior, Yahushua Messiah, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of Elohim and Yahushua the Messiah, our Master, Kepha Bet, or 2 Peter 1, 1-4. Contrast this to Clement's first epistle, in which he uses his position as the Bishop of Rome as a kind of a bully pulpit, demanding that the assembly in Corinth conform to his doctrines and decrees. Here's 1 Clement 1:1. That would indicate that's the first verse, first chapter. The Church of Elohim, which is at Rome, to the Church of Elohim, which is at Corinth. Clement then goes on to demand that the laity at Corinth submit itself to the clergy, setting a precedent that the Bishop of Rome could dictate orders to the other assemblies. Rather than encouraging brothers, Clement initiates a long papal tradition of talking down to one's alleged inferiors. The idea of a power structure in Israel was not new. Israel had known military hierarchy since the days of Moshe. What was new was that the leadership should be so haughty and so presumptuous, and that the spiritual nation of Israel should be led by a series of increasingly warlike, sun-worshipping demi-deities who relocated the spiritual center to the nation of Rome, or of the nation to Rome, rather. In 2 Thessalonians, the apostle Shaul, who we know as Paul, warned the first century believers of a man of sin who would sit in a coming temple pretending to be Elohim himself. 2 Thessalonians 2, 3-4. Do not let anyone deceive you in any way, because that day will not come unless first comes the falling away, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, the one opposing and exalting himself over everything being called Elohim or object of worship, so as for him to sit in the temple of Elohim as Elohim, showing himself that he is Elohim. 1 John 3:4 tells us that sin is the transgression of the law. Therefore, if sin is the transgression of the law, the man of sin in verse 3 might well be called the man of lawlessness. And who has done more to teach against the law than the Pope? 2 Thessalonians 2:7 and 8. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work, only he is holding back now until it comes out of the midst, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom Yahuwah will consume by the spirit of his mouth. In the first century, the lawless one had yet to be revealed, and Shaul wrote about a future revelation. Because of this, the majority of the Christian world still looks for a coming anti-Messiah, not realizing that he has been in power for some 1,700 years already. The Pope not only sits in a kind of a temple, showing himself as Elohim, but he also fulfills the prophecy of Daniel 7:25. Daniel 7:25 speaks of a little horn who would attempt to change the appointed festival times and the law. He would also seek to exterminate the Nazarenes, thereby wearing them out, for 3.5 prophetic years. And he, the Pope, shall speak words contrary to the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and he intends to change the appointed feast times and the law. And they, the saints, shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time. Daniel 7:25. This reference to the saints being given over into the papacy's hand for a time, times, and half a time is a reference to the approximately 1260 years in between the formation of the Roman Catholic Church dogma in the early 300s until the Protestant Reformation finally got underway in the late 1500s. The time, two times, and half a time in this passage is a reference to 3.5 prophetic times, meaning 3.5 prophetic years. There are 360 days in the Hebrew calendar, and when one multiplies these 360 days in a year times the 3.5 prophetic years, one gets 1260 prophetic days, which correspond to 1260 earth years. Scripture tells us that the Messiah is the head or leader of every man, 1 Corinthians 11:3. The implication is that while there has often been leadership in Israel, it was never supposed to be self-appointed, but was always supposed to be appointed by Elohim for someone to intentionally exalt himself as a kind of a demi-deity. Claiming to be a stand-in for the Messiah is the very foundation of the spirit of anti-Messiah. It should be noted that contrary to popular belief, in Greek, the term anti does not mean against, rather it means instead of or in the place of. Therefore, an anti-Messiah is not someone who tries to destroy the Messiah, but someone who pretends to be the Messiah or his literal representative. How interesting, then, that the Pope claims the title Vicar of Christ, by which he claims to be the vicarious representative of the Messiah on earth. All of this is strictly against the Torah and against Yahushua's words. Yahushua not only said to call no man rabbi, but he also said to call no man on earth our father. This is Matityahu or Matthew 23:8-9. But you do not be called rabbi, for one is your teacher, the Messiah, and you are all brethren. And call no one on earth your father, for one is your father, the one in heaven. Yahushua's words are plain enough. Do not call any man on earth your father. However, the term Pope literally translates to Papa or Father. Further, the Pope's crown or mitre is inscribed with the title Vicarius Filii Dei. This title literally means in place of the Son of the Deity or instead of the Son of the Deity. The Pope's title, then, is the exact definition of the term anti-Messiah. Additionally, certain languages assign numerical values to each of their letters. Greek is this way. When one adds up the Greek numerical value of the Latin title that is inscribed on the Pope's crown, Vicarius Filii Dei, one gets the numerical value of 666. Here is wisdom. Here is wisdom. Let the one having reason count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and its number is 666. That's Revelation 13:18. Genesis is generally considered prophetic, and it sets the pattern for the same type of events to recur later on in Scripture. Notice then that even back in the Garden of Eden, the adversary appeared to Eve and tried to get her to abandon Yahuwah's commandments by implying there would be no negative consequences for disobeying Yahuwah's commandments or laws. This is Bereshit 3. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which Yahuwah Elohim had made. And he said to the woman, "Has Elohim indeed said, 'You shall not eat of every tree of the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, "You shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die."'" The Catholic Vicar of Christ essentially says the same thing by insinuating that we can inherit eternal life while disregarding the marital covenant. Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for Elohim knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like Elohim, knowing good and evil." And this is Bereshit, which means in the beginnings, 3, verses 4 and 5. Protestantism, the last 10 tribes. Many people have heard of the last 10 tribes of Israel, but few people know much about them. Scripture tells us that Israel had 12 sons, each of whom would later head one of the 12 tribes. 10 of those tribes were exiled from the land of Israel some 2,700 years ago for their disobedience to the Torah. Jonathan and I have talked to you guys about there was a 2,730-year curse on the 10 northern tribes. Now, where Norman Willis will go with this is that those 2,730 years began when the northern tribes left the land of Israel. Well, they started leaving at 1 year, and then they continued leaving until another year. He is going to give you a date. I believe it's in this chapter, but if not, it'll be soon. He's going to give you a date of the earliest people leaving and then added 2,730 years to that, which put him approximately 1995. But we maintain that the countdown of those years began as the last people left the land, and that 2,730 years for that group would have been 2009-2010, which most people will agree, if they are paying attention at all, that this is when many of the Christians started leaving the church and started studying on their own and started having a desire, a more intense desire, to learn Hebrew and to know the Father's name and to search out the truth of the matter about our pagan traditions and holidays, and wanted to go back to the land, wanted to learn Hebrew, wanted to learn about keeping the feast of Yahuwah and the calendar of Yahuwah. So that's about the time all that happened. All right, here we go. Many people have heard of the lost 10 tribes of Israel, but few people know much about them. Scripture tells us that Israel had 12 sons, each of whom would later head one of the tribes. 10 of these tribes were exiled from the land of Israel some 2,700 years ago for their disobedience to the Torah. After the 10 tribes were taken captive by the Assyrians, they were deposited in the lands that make up modern-day Syria and Iraq. However, after some years had passed, these 10 tribes then migrated from these Assyrian lands and subsequently became lost to popular history. But if the 10 tribes became lost, then where are they now? Logically, they have to be somewhere. You have to admit that. They have to be somewhere. Certainly, they have been preserved, because the word for north, like they were the 10 northern tribes, the word for north is the same word for hidden. And then Jonathan found out just this week that that same word for north and hidden, when you read it from left to right, it says scattered. So there's a coinkydink. Prophecy tells us that they will someday return. Then from where will they return? There is a theory called the two-house theory that explains where the lost 10 tribes of Israel are right now. As a radical oversimplification, the two-house theory tells us that the Protestant Christian peoples, and especially the American Protestant Christians, are the prophetic, if not also the literal descendants of the lost 10 tribes of Israel. Okay, I want to tell you something right here, and I want to be really clear about this. I went looking for this two-house theory a couple days ago, and I saw an overwhelming amount of material written up against this two-house theory. I once heard it said that if you want the truth of something, you go on past the first page and maybe the second page, and then you'll start finding the truth. There's a lot of stuff put on the internet to dissuade you from finding out who you are. The enemy will always try to steal any truth coming at you. He does not want you knowing who you are. I'll just say that. If there's anything that you're supposed to know and supposed to do, the enemy's done everything he can to hide it from you and to obliterate it and to discount it and tell you, oh, you don't have to do that. Oh, you don't have to keep that. Oh, you really shouldn't do that. There's no reason. It's all been nailed to the cross. So point being, you have an enemy. Any truth that comes into you and you start thinking about it, by tomorrow you might have forgotten it, and like maybe for a year or 2 years. So you want to hold on, make notes, take notes, research out the truth of the matter and then walk in the truth of the matter. You've got to let your fruit grow up. You got to let your plants like grow up. You got to water them in the truth. Okay. It should be stressed that this theory in no way excludes anyone based upon race, ethnic heritage, or present nationality. This theory only explains the mechanics of how the prophecies were historically carried out. However, if we accept the tenets of this theory, then we can understand some other unique phenomena that have no other scriptural explanation. This study will not reiterate the extensive historical and archaeological research that has already been done on the migrations of the tribes. Those wishing to learn more about the archaeological findings can refer to the work of Captain Collins, Davidi, or White. Now, we've shared a lot of Stephen M. Collins' book on the Israel's tribes today, which is his third or fourth of those many books. And we've read it online, so it's available. You can go and read through, listen through that book that we recorded just a couple of months ago. Our purpose here is simply to build upon the results of these studies and to put them into a larger overall framework. This framework will demonstrate that one of the primary reasons Yahushua first came was to begin a centuries-long process of regathering the lost tribes of Israel, otherwise known as the House of Ephraim or the House of Israel. When one knows to look for it, the signs are all over the Word. It is so true. They're all over the Word. Every time you open up the what we've known as the Old Testament, which is like the First Testament, and it's called the Tanakh, we'll see where Yahuwah is talking to the house of Israel or to the house of Ephraim. Well, he's talking to our ancestors. When one knows to look for it, the signs are all over the world. Yes, they are. Matityahu or Matthew 15:24, but he answered and said, I was not sent at this time except for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As we will explain in the chapters that follow, this regathering process was to take place in sequential phases or steps. The first step was to establish the original faith of the apostles as well as its Christian variation. This was accomplished in Yahushua's time. The next step was to allow the Roman Empire to co-opt this Christian permutation and merge it with sun worship, forming the Catholic or universal variation of the Christian faith. We have already shown that by making a variation of the belief that would glorify and exalt the Roman Emperor as a demi-deity, i.e. the Pope, the Roman Emperor would then have a personal incentive to spread the good news throughout his empire much faster than the Nazarenes would have been able to spread it in the same amount of time. The third step in the regathering of the House of Ephraim, the Lost Ten Tribes, was the Protestant Reformation, which would begin a generations-long return process back to the covenant and the original belief. Although the Protestants may not always have understood that they were, in fact, attempting to return to the original belief, does not alter the fact that this is where the Protestant Reformation has ultimately been taking them. Finally, the fourth phase calls for a separation between the remnant that desires to come all the way back to the marital covenant and the land of Israel and the masses of Christendom who do not. And as will be explained in the chapters that follow, a number of prophecies specify that this final phase of the regathering process began in or about 1996, the Common Era. This may be true for those whose ancestors may have began to come out of the land at this time, 2,930 years prior to 1996. But the last ones that came out, 2,730 years times that, or added to that, brings you up to 2009. Since prophecy tells us that this final phase has already started, we should be able to look at the world and find a group of believers in the Messiah, both Protestant and otherwise, who are attempting to reestablish their identity as the lost 10 tribes of Israel. There are, in fact, several such groups, and their numbers are rapidly growing. There may be organized groups, or they may be people on their own all over the world. And you probably are aware, you've probably witnessed this, where people are identifying themselves as being Hebrew, and they are doing their best to be Hebrew. Since the promises of the two-house theory are being borne out right before our eyes, it is clearly a true theory, and therefore we should endeavor to understand it as completely as possible. Because 20 years ago, we were all members in a church, and now, today, that's not the way it is. However, in order to do that, we must first understand the origins of the 12 tribes of Israel. To recap the story, Abraham begat Yitzhak, or Abraham begat Isaac, and then Yitzhak begat Yaakov, who was later renamed Israel, or Yisrael. Israel had 12 sons. Each of these sons then fathered one of the 12 tribes of Israel, as they are called. The names of these tribes in order of birth are Reuben, Simeon, Levi or Lui, Yehuda, Dan or Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher or Asher, Yisachar or Yisachar, Zebulun, Yosef, and Benjamin or Benjamin. The 11th child, Yosef, had two sons. The names of these sons were Menashe or Manasseh and Ephraim. Yosef's father, Yisrael, then commanded that both Menashe and Ephraim should be thought of as separate tribes, indicating that Yosef was to have a double-sized inheritance, as the word says. Thus, from the 12 tribes, one tribe, Yosef, was taken away, and two tribes were added in its place, Yosef's sons, Menashe and Ephraim. This meant that instead of only 12 tribes in Israel, now there were 13. However, the tribe of Lui or Levi was later broken up and scattered among the rest of the tribes in order to minister to them. For this reason, Lui was not numbered among the tribes. So now the number of tribes returned to 12. So if anybody says to you 13 tribes or 12 tribes, they're both right. Because of all the number juggling involved in counting Yisrael's tribes, it is not incorrect to say that there are 13 tribes. However, the convention is just to call them the 12 tribes of Yisrael, or Israel. Moreover, as we will see two chapters from now, a division came about between the northern 10 tribes called the House of Israel, the House of Ephraim, and or the House of Yosef, and the southern two tribes, who are called the House of Yehuda, or just Jacob, or Yaakov, in prophecy. The 10 were separated from the 2, and are only just now beginning to come back together. So we are coming back together. There's a reason for that. This is what the two-house theory explains. The book of Genesis is said to be prophetic in that the patterns established in Genesis tend to repeat themselves later on. This is also why it is said that the end is known from the beginning. In the book of beginnings, then, Yehuda sells Yosef into slavery, and Yosef is then thrown into prison for a crime he never committed. This, then, is a prophetic shadow of events that will later befall the house of Yosef, or Israel, or Ephraim. After spending several years in prison, Yosef is called before Pharaoh for his Elohim-given ability to interpret dreams. Because he interprets Pharaoh's dreams correctly and gives wise advice, Yosef is seen as a sage, and for this reason he is made second in command of all Egypt. Yosef then uses his power and position to help Pharaoh consolidate his hold on Egypt. Again, all this is prophetic of future events regarding the lost 10 tribes. Yosef is then given to wife Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, the Egyptian high priest. Asenath then bore two sons unto Yosef. The older son's name was Menashe, and the younger son's name was Ephraim. We should note here that Genesis 1 informs us that living beings reproduce after their own kinds. So here we have in Bereshit, or Genesis 1:11, then Elohim said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb that yields seed, and the fruit tree that yields fruit according to its kind, whose seed is in itself on the earth, and it was so. Since human beings also contain their seed within themselves and therefore reproduce after their own kinds, we might expect Yosef's two children to grow up to be partly good Hebrews because of Yosef and partly very spiritual pagans because of Asenath's father, Potipharah, the Egyptian high priest. This is exactly what we do see. While Menashe and Ephraim were undoubtedly real people, they also serve as prophetic shadow pictures of what later became the Christians of the greater British Empire, including America. As we have seen, Christians in general are partly good Hebrews and partly very spiritual pagans, given to altering the true worship to include numerous pagan rites, rituals, and sun worship festival days. It should further be noted that the names of the children were both prophetic. The older son's name, Menashe, roughly translates to "he will forget his toil and his father's house." This is a prophetic picture of England, where the Industrial Revolution began. The Industrial Revolution helped the British people and their descendants to forget their labors and their toil. Sadly, however, they also forgot their father's house, the temple. Some might suggest that this is the reason for all of the anti-Semitic bias found on British radio and television stations, such as the BBC and others. After Yosef called his father Israel and the rest of the family down into Egypt, Yosef's father Israel prophesied that both of Yosef's sons would eventually become great. However, Israel prophesied that Yosef's younger son Ephraim would ultimately become the greater of the two. So Yosef brought them from beside his knees, and he bowed down with his face to the earth, and Yosef took them both, Ephraim with his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Menashe with his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near him. Then Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it on Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand on Menashe's head, guiding his hands knowingly, for Menashe was the firstborn. And he blessed Yosef and said, "Elohim, before whom my fathers Abraham and Yitzhak walked, the Elohim who has fed me all my life long to this day, the messenger who has redeemed me from all evil, bless the youth. Let my name be renamed upon them, and the name of my fathers Abraham and Yitzhak, and let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth." Okay, I just want to pause right here and say that with our reading of Stephen M. Collins, he happens to disagree with Norman Willis, as I believe most of the other researchers who have really specialized on finding the lost tribes today, lost to themselves, but not to Yahuwah, hidden by Yahuwah. Stephen M. Collins, as well as the other researchers of the 12 tribes, I believe, for the most part, believe that the United States is Menashe, and the United Kingdom and all of its major territories, including Australia and Canada and New Zealand and all their little islands and territories they've had, have been Ephraim. Hebrew is a very special language. In the Hebrew, this phrase, "grow into a multitude," also has a hidden meaning, like a multitude of fishes. This is a hint that Ephraim and Menashe would become like a multitude of fish. What people have grown into, a multitude in the midst of the earth, and have adopted the fish as their symbol. Only the Christians have done this, and in particular, the British and American Christians. Now, when Yosef saw that his father Israel laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased him, so he took hold of his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head to Menashe's head. And Yosef said to his father, "Not so, my father, for this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head." But his father Israel refused and said, "I know my son Yosef. I know he," or Menashe, "also shall become a people, and he also shall be great. But truly his younger brother Ephraim shall be greater than he, and his descendants shall become a multitude of nations," or the completeness of the nations. Scholars take many different meanings from the phrase "the completeness of the nations." However, it indicates that Ephraim would ultimately become a multitude of nations and greater than his older brother, more numerous and or more prosperous. Originally conceived as a Protestant Christian nation, America is richer, more populous than England. Yes, but not all of England's lands and territories. And has become a multitude of nations in that it is comprised of 50 original sovereign states. That's not exactly a multitude of nations. Further, in that America is comprised of people from virtually every tribe and nation and tongue, America also serves as the completeness of the nations. Okay, so really the completeness of the nations, it's in Genesis 48:19, and the Hebrew phrase is Milo HaGoyim, and it means the fullness of the Gentiles. And Jonathan is reminding me it's in Matthew 24, which for it's in Matthew 24. So you can check it out there.
An indicator of the end of times would be the fullness of the Gentiles, just like Jacob said.
Okay, and we've definitely grown up as Gentiles, so we like totally get that. We like have had this whole identity as, hey, we are Gentiles. Well, the fullness of the Gentiles, that has to do with Ephraim. And Ephraim was like the mascot of all 10 tribes. That's why in the scriptures it talks about the house of Israel and the house of Ephraim. He was like the mascot. He was like the leader of all the tribes. Because those two boys, Ephraim and Manasseh, they got a double portion. They got that double portion was divided between them. Beyond this, it is important to remember that names in scripture are always prophetic. The name Ephraim, and I would suggest to you that names are prophetic. The name Ephraim means both doubly fruitful and prodigious. When we look for a Protestant Christian nation that is greater than its older brother, is a multitude of nations, is doubly fruitful and prodigiously blessed. The only real logical candidate is Protestant Christian America. And I would say that it is America and all of the United Kingdom altogether, all in the countries that they have populated and controlled.
And that just goes to point out the two different opinions on who Manasseh and Ephraim are.
Yeah.
But the one thing to remember is they both are Manasseh and Ephraim.
They're both Yosef.
Which has been debatable.
Again, this does not exclude anyone from the covenant or make America more than it is. Yahuwah loves all of his children, and he has extended his salvation to all of the nations of the world. All this explanation does is to explain the mechanics of how the prophecies were historically carried out. There are other historically non-British nations, such as South Africa, that have strong Hebrew roots movements within them. For this reason, it would be wrong to suggest that the heirs to the kingdom will come only from England and or America. Yahushua himself even says that many will come from the East. And before I read the scripture, let me just say that with United States and the United Kingdom and Canada and Australia and New Zealand and the other United Kingdom territories being the descendants of Yosef, there, Yosef means he will accumulate, and it's speaking about Yahuwah will accumulate, but he's going to use Yosef's descendants to do that. So there is a spiritual current and future meaning of that we will be involved in Yahuwah's business and his purpose of accumulating and harvesting his field, I believe. Matit Yahu 8:11, and I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Yitzhak, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Many will come. Hallelujah. Racism has no part to play.
Absolutely none. As a matter of fact, you have Asian Hebrews. You have black Hebrews. You got Scottish Hebrews. You may not know it. You may not even know your identity. Here's a good ironic situation. The Palestinians, a lot of those that are, quote, the Palestinians that fight against the Israelites, guess what? They're actually cousins. They're related. So, you know, they don't even know it, that they are, some of them are Hebrew.
Okay, racism has no part to play in extending Yahushua's salvation to all of the children of fallen Adam. The commandment in Matthew 28 was to go unto all nations and make disciples. This cannot properly be construed as meaning only Britain or America. However, to recognize that America does indeed play a special prophetic role is only logical. And you know what? You can see it today. You can see many American watchmen. You can see many calling forth for the Gentile remnant to come into knowledge of who they are. While anti-Semitism has abounded in Christian America, as elsewhere, there has been something of a reversal of this trend since the Second World War, as if prophecy were entering a new phase. Let's just say that again, a new phase. Further, while anti-Semitism does exist in America, it has usually been somewhat milder than in Europe. America has stood by Israel since its inception in 1948, and it is sometimes said that America is the only earthly friend that Israel has. Okay, I want to explain something real quick here. The word Semitic, that comes from the word shame. When Noah had three sons that came off the ark, went on the ark and came off the ark with him, he had Shem, Ham, and Japheth. That name Shem is really shame, and it means name. Okay, it'd be just like if we had a boat and we had three sons on it, and we had one son named Name, and one son that meant forever, and one son that meant, I don't know, potato salad. Okay, so but one of them was named Name. That name is shame, and we pronounced it as Shem, but it really means shame, which is sort of an interesting thing because a lot of people have shame about the name. But in Hebrew, shame is not shame; it's name. So that's what the word anti-Semitism is about. It's about the children of Shemitic people,
and they were the ones that those came from Mesopotamia, the Shemitic people.
And they carried the name of Yahuwah. So this is against the name of Yahuwah, the people who carry the name of Yahuwah, okay?
Abraham came from that area as a Shemite.
Yes. And obviously, he came from Noah, right? Eventually, Noah was the father of all the living people. So obviously, Semitism was one of the shame was one of the three sons that came off of that ark. Okay, further, while anti-Semitism does exist in America, okay, I read that paragraph. If America stands by Israel, it is only because the American Protestant Christians desire to see Israel protected for a variety of theological and humanitarian reasons that Israel does not presently understand the Protestant Christian basis of America's support does not alter the fact that it is basically America's Protestantism that makes her a friend to Israel. But what is it that has caused America to be a relatively pro-Israel Protestant nation? How'd that happen? It has been the fact that America is the modern-day prophetic representative of the tribe of Ephraim, and I maintain it's the tribe of Menashe because I've seen the evidence otherwise. The special relationship that exists between America and England is the brotherhood between the two sons of Joseph, Ephraim and Menashe. So we're talking about the United States, the United Kingdom, part of Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and any of the other territories that have been involved with United Kingdom. The special relationship that exists between America and England is the brotherhood between the two sons of Joseph, Ephraim and Menashe, which I just said. Likewise, the special relationship between America and Israel is the relationship between the house of Ephraim and the house of Yehuda. I would say it's the house of Menashe and the house of Yehuda. Remember, Menashe was down there. It was divided into two like tribes. They had some land down further south, and they had some land further north, much more land further north. There was almost always fighting and rivalry between the two houses, but more often than not, when times got tough, the two houses clung together, and so it will be in the future. However, so that we can understand some of the secrets of the renewed covenant better, let us learn a little bit more about the 12 tribes of Israel and their later division into two houses. The nation divided. After Joseph passed on, New kings arose in Egypt who did not know of all the good things that Joseph had done for Egypt and for Pharaoh. These new kings feared Israel's children, and so they chose to enslave them. The bondage in Egypt was hard. Then 430 years after Israel's descendants first went down into Egypt, Yahuwah sent a man named Moshe to draw them out. Moshe brought Israel's children through the Reed Sea, and then into the wilderness of Sinai. Then some 50 days later, they were given the Torah at the foot of Mount Sinai, which constituted their betrothal. At that time, they were told that they would be brought into the promised land, the land of Canaan. Knowing that Yahuwah was leading them to the land of Canaan, Moshe sent 12 spies into the land to spy it out. However, of the 12 spies, only two of them brought back a positive report. Their names of the two bringing back a positive report were Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, of the tribe of Judah, and Joshua, the son of Nun, of the tribe of Ephraim. Both Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, "The land we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land." Bamidbar, or Numbers 14:6. Incidentally, the word Bamidbar, which is the real name of the book, it means in the desert I will speak to them, or in the wilderness I will speak to them. It is very symbolic that the two spies bringing back the good report were from the tribes of Judah and Ephraim. These two tribes represent what later came to be known as the two houses of Israel. The southernmost house was that of Yehuda or Jacob, and it consisted of the tribes of Yehuda and Benjamin or Benjamin. These two tribes together with some of Levi are what we think of as the Jews of today. In contrast, the northern 10 tribes were called the house of Israel, the house of Ephraim, and or the house of Joseph. While these three terms are all synonymous, these are different than the Jews. This is because there are prophecies over both Judah and Israel that have yet to be fulfilled. For example, this is Yirmiyahu, which means the exaltation of Yahuwah. That's the real name of the book, but we know it is Jeremiah 3:18. In those days, the house of Yehuda shall walk with the house of Israel, and they shall come together out of the land of the north to the land that I have given as an inheritance to your fathers. Scripture definitely prophesies different things over Yehuda than it does over Israel, and unless one understands the distinction between the two groups, the prophecies can seem to be just one big mass of jumbled, conflicting material. Christians expect the prophecies to conflict with each other because it reinforces their dogma that the Messiah would have to come and do away with them. But does the Christian hypothesis really make sense? Does the Father contradict himself, or did he send his Son to blot out his allegedly meaningless ramblings? The entire concept is an insult to Yahuwah. The two houses of Israel and Yehuda are clearly two separate, distinct groups of people. Hosea 1:11. Incidentally, this whole book is written to the house of Ephraim, which most of that is in the modern day churches or has come out of the modern day churches. So you need to read that book and say, hey, he's talking to me here. Then the children of Yehuda and the children of Israel shall be gathered together and appoint for themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great will be the day of Jezreel. The church, however, does not understand the two houses, so they have never taught on it. Rather, they mistakenly conclude that today's Jewry, or those who are Jews, represents all of the 12 tribes of Israel. And by the way, the house of Yehuda, the Jews, they propagate this and perpetuate it as well. They talk about it as if, hey, we got the Torah at Mount Sinai. No, all 12 tribes were there, all 12 tribes. There are 12 tribes then, there's 12 tribes now. Even though the other 11 are really like kind of quiet right now because most of them don't know who they are.
Yeah, there's a level of racism within the tribes because the rest of the tribes were grafted in or mingled in to the nations. That's how Yahuwah was to save the world, was to grab those tribes into the nations. And the actual Jews, the Orthodox, the Haredi, totally despise that. So they cannot see that and fathom how that's even possible, or how you can prove that you're part of the tribes. But we don't have to prove that to them. The Father knows who we are. He knows who you are.
And we should be able to prove it by the fruit of our lives, because Yahushua says we can judge people by the fruit of their lives. And part of the reason I think that Yehuda did not accept us or look for us is because we were, our ancestors back in the day were so involved in idolatry, they just had to divorce themselves from us and let us go as brothers, because they saw how much idolatry we were involved in. They're like, they can't stay, they gotta go. They can't be a part of what Yahuwah is doing here. After Moshe's death, Yahshua led the children of Israel in the conquest of the land of Canaan. Then came the period of Judges, and then 1 and 2 Samuel. During these periods, the tribes were not held together under any kind of strong central leadership, and consequently they languished. After Judges and Samuel came the period of 1 and 2 Kings. After King Shaul's reign, King David, or Dawid, united the Israelite people, vanquished their enemies, and then led Israel's children back to the marital covenant. Scholars agree that Yahshua and King Dawid established the classical Hebrew standard for a Messiah. So like that was like a picture of the Messiah. Yahushua and King Dawid, they were like a picture of the Messiah. A Messiah, or an anointed one, is a divinely appointed leader who vanquishes the enemies of Israel, unites Israel's children. So let's listen to that. Vanquishes the enemies of Israel, wherever they be, even if they don't know who they are, vanquishes their enemies. Unites the children, brings the children back together, and then brings the lost and scattered of Israel back to the eternal covenant.
Yeah, and this is a paradigm to that, because that he also uses Mashiachs that are wicked to do his work as well, to drive, to judge. Nebuchadnezzar was a Mashiach. He was an anointed one. So the word has a broad use to it. It means the anointed one.
He has a purpose.
That's right, he has a purpose.
Although most Christians may not realize it, this is exactly the role that Yahushua is fulfilling, these three things. Although it is taking place so slowly that one cannot fully understand how he is doing it without an overview of both covenants. When Yahushua died, the Jews were not able to see how he was gathering in the lost and scattered of Israel's children, nor could they see how he had vanquished Israel's enemies. So they couldn't see the Messiah because they didn't see how he had done these things. Moreover, because of widespread misunderstanding of Shaul's epistles, many Jews believed that Yahushua had come to destroy the covenant. For all of these many reasons, the Jews rejected Yahushua as their Messiah. However, as the fourth and final phase of the regathering of the lost 10 tribes continues, and the Nazarene movement continues to grow, the Jews will slowly begin to see that Yahushua really is their Messiah. They will see that he truly is regathering Israel's lost and scattered children from every tribe and tongue and nation, and that he truly is bringing them back to the eternal covenant. When that happens, and the Jews see Yahushua's followers zealous for the Torah in large numbers, there will be no separating the Jewish people from their Messiah. Yet while there are other reasons for the history of conflict between Christians and Jews, the violence can in many ways be traced to the ancient rivalries that have always existed between Israel's two houses. These rivalries have existed ever since Yosef first dreamed and his brothers became jealous. But by the time of King Dawid, these rivalries had become intense. And the men of Israel answered the men of Yehuda and said, "We have 10 shares in the king, therefore we also have more right to Dawid than you. Why then do you despise us? Were we not the first to advise bringing back our king? Yet the words of the men of Yehuda were fiercer than the words of the men of Israel. 2 Samuel 19:42 and 43. Despite their sibling rivalries, King DeWitt was able to unite the tribes and keep them together. However, after DeWitt had grown old, his son Solomon, or Shlomo, which means our peace, began to reign. With Shlomo's reign, a number of problems developed. Shlomo had taken a large number of foreign wives. These wives were called foreign in that they never converted to Israelite worship. The problem was not that Shlomo's wives were foreign-born. Rather, the problem was that they never converted to the worship of Yahuwah, as had Ruth, but continued to worship their pagan deities. Thus it happened that in an effort to please his idolatrous wives, Shlomo began to practice the same forms of idolatry as they did, even though Yahuwah had personally warned him not to. So I would say it looked like he was trying to keep the peace. His name was Our Peace, trying to keep the peace in his own home. But King Shlomo loved many foreign women, as well as the daughter of Pharaoh. Women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites, from the nations of whom Yahuwah had said to the children of Israel, "You shall not intermarry with them, nor they with you, for surely they will turn away your hearts after their Elohim, or mighty ones." Shlomo clung to these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it was so when Shlomo was old that his wives turned his heart after other Elohim, and his heart was not loyal to Yahuwah his Elohim, as was the heart of his father DeWitt. For Shlomo went after Ashtoreth, or Easter, the deities of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. Shlomo did evil in the sight of Yahuwah, and did not fully follow Yahuwah as did his father DeWitt. Then Shlomo built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, on the hill that is east of Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the people of Ammon. And he did likewise for all his foreign wives who burned incense and sacrificed to their Elohim. So Yahuwah became angry with Shlomo because his heart had turned away from Yahuwah Elohim of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing, and that he should not go after other Elohim. But he did not keep what Yahuwah had commanded. Therefore Yahuwah said to Shlomo, "Because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father DeWitt, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away the whole kingdom. I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my servant DeWitt, and one more for the sake of Yerushalayim, which I have chosen." Melachim Aleph, 1 Kings. Solomon, or Shlomo, also took a large number of slaves from the northern house of Ephraim, both to build the temple and his own personal estate. For example, when we read in Ecclesiastes about the magnificent gardens and pools that King Shlomo had built, these were all built by slaves from the house of Joseph. "I made my works great, I built myself houses, and planted myself vineyards. I made myself gardens and orchards, and I planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made myself water pools from which to water the growing trees of the grove. I acquired male and female servants, and had servants born in my house. Yes, I had greater possessions of herds and flocks than all who were in Jerusalem before me." King Shlomo took multitudes of slaves from the northern house of Joseph. However, we never read of his having taken slaves from the house of Yehuda. Then Shlomo's servant Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, an Ephraimite from Zeretha, whose mother's name was Zeruah, a widow, also rebelled against the king. And this is what caused him to rebel against the king. Shlomo had built the Milo, the citadel, and repaired the damages to the city of DeWitt his father. The man Jeroboam was a mighty man of valor. And Shlomo, seeing that the young man was industrious, made him the officer over all the slave labor force of the house of Joseph, or the house of Ephraim. Melchim Aleph, or 1 Kings 11:26-28. The main problem, though, was Shlomo's idolatry. In verse 11 above, Yahuwah had promised to punish Shlomo for serving his wife's foreign deities by tearing the rein out of Shlomo's son's hand, thereby leaving only two tribes for Shlomo's son to rule over. In verse 29, then, we see how this tearing away of the rein would be carried out. Now it happened at that time, when Jeroboam went out of Jerusalem, that the prophet Ahijah the Shilonite met him on the way, and he had clothed himself with a new garment, and the two were alone in the field. Then Ahijah took hold of the new garment that was on him, and tore it into 12 pieces. And he said to Jeroboam, "Take for yourself 10 pieces, one piece for each of the 10 tribes. 10 pieces, one piece for each of the 10 tribes. For thus says Yahuwah, the Elohim of Israel, behold, I will tear the kingdom out of the hand of Shlomo, and will give 10 tribes to you. But his son shall have one tribe for the sake of my servant Dawid, and one more for the sake of Jerusalem, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel. Because they have forsaken me and worshipped Ashtoreth," which is Easter, "the deities of the Sidonians, Chemosh, the Elohim of the Moabites, and Milcom, the Elohim of the people of Ammon, and have not walked in my ways to do what is right in my eyes, and keep my statutes and my judgments, as did his father Dawid. However, I will not take the whole kingdom out of his hand, because I have made him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of my servant Dawid, whom I chose because he kept my commandments and my statutes. But I will take the kingdom out of his son's hand and give it to you, 10 tribes." So that's 1 Kings 11:29-35. Yahuwah tells Jeroboam through Ahijah that he loved Dawid because Dawid kept his commandments. Ahijah prophesied that if Jeroboam will also keep the commandments, then the house of Israel will be established as the new lead house. "So I will take you, and you shall reign over all your heart desires, and you shall be king over Israel. Then it shall be, if you heed all that I command you, walk in my ways, and do what is right in my sight, to keep my statutes and my commandments, as my servant Dawid did, then I will be with you, and build for you an enduring house, as I built for Dawid, and will give Israel to you. And I will afflict the descendants of Dawid," for instance the Jews, "because of this, but not forever." Melchim Aleph, 1 Kings 11:37-39. Notice that the curse over Judah is not forever. Also, notice that Yahuwah's promise that he would make Ephraim into the new Israel was only conditional. Israel would only be the new lead because as long as they kept his commandments. Let's read that again. Israel would only be the new lead house as long as they kept his commandments. Then in 1 Kings chapter 12, the house of Israel rebelled out from under Shlomo's son Rehoboam. After they did this, they established Jeroboam as their new king. Jeroboam knew that he had to lead the people to keep the Torah, but he had a problem in that the Torah calls for the people to go out up to Jerusalem 3 times a year. Jerusalem, however, was back in King Rehoboam's country in the southern kingdom. And Jeroboam said in his heart, "Now the king may return to the house of Dawid, Judah. For if these people go up to offer sacrifices in the house of Yahuwah at Jerusalem, then the heart of this people will turn back to their Lord Rehoboam, king of Judah, and then they will kill me and then go back to Rehoboam, the king of Judah." Jeroboam knows he must teach his people to go up to Jerusalem if Israel is to remain the new lead house. However, if his people go up to Jerusalem, his people will ultimately kill him. Jeroboam then comes up with a plan. "Therefore the king asked advice, made 2 calves of gold, and said to the people, 'It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem for the festivals. Here are your deities, O Israel, which brought you up from the land of Egypt. And he set up one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. Now this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one as far as Dan. He made shrines on the high places, and made priests from every class of people who were not of the sons of Levi. Jeroboam ordained a feast on the 15th day of the 8th month, like the feast that was in Yehuda, which would have been on the 15th day of the 7th month, so a whole month later. So he did at Bethel, sacrificing to the calves that he had made. And at Bethel he installed the priests of the high places which he had made. So he made offerings on the altar which he had made at Bethel on the 15th day of the 8th month, in the month which he had devised in his own heart. And he ordained a feast for the children of Israel, and offered sacrifices on the altar and burnt incense. 1 Kings 12:25-33. We will see a number of parallels here between the northern kingdom and the Christian church. Notice what happened. Jeroboam pushed the fall festivals backwards from the 7th month to the 8th month. Now there are some who have studied the calendar this year and believe that this is what is happening with the house of Yehuda this year. We are keeping it a month earlier than they are. And I believe that was Joseph Dumont's ministry that we saw that in. He set up false houses of worship and then set up visible objects or idols for the people to worship. He made priests of just anyone, and not only the sons of Levi or Levi. He told the people that his new religious system was legitimate, even though it departed from the Torah. Point for point, this is the exact same pattern that the Christian church would later follow. The church pushed the fall festivals backwards from the fall into the winter. They moved the center of worship from Jerusalem to Rome, set up a false temple, and established idols in the form of statuettes and graven images within. Next, they made priests out of just anyone rather than the sons of Levi. The pattern established in the Garden of Eden is this. When we obey Yahuwah's laws, we get to live in his special land, and he himself takes care of us. However, when we disobey his laws, he kicks us out of the land and then draws out the sword after us until we repent. For Israel, this is what would soon happen. Much like the Torahless Christians, we would later claim to be the new Israel. Jeroboam's Ephraim had become the new lead house, but only for a time. Since they no longer obeyed the eternal covenant, they would no longer be allowed to dwell in the covenant land because they were defiling it. Just as the Christians would later be scattered to the four corners of the earth, Jeroboam's northern kingdom of Israel went before them. They would be scattered from the land of Israel for their failure to obey Yahuwah's Torah. However, as we will see, all this was to fulfill the promises given to the patriarchs. The final warnings. Yahuwah sent prophets to the northern kingdom, warning them of the disasters that awaited them if they did not repent. Among these prophets was Hosea. Hosea 1:1. When Yahuwah began to speak by Hosea, Yahuwah said to Hosea, "Go, take yourself a wife of harlotry and have children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry by departing from Yahuwah." Idolatry is spiritual adultery against Yahuwah, and because the house of Ephraim had consorted with other Elohim or other deities, Hosea had to take a harlot as a wife. This was symbolic of Ephraim's harlotry. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim. The name Gomer means finished. Yahuwah was saying that even his great patience was at an end. And she conceived and bore him a son. Then Yahuwah said to him, "Call his name Jezreel, for in a little while I will avenge the bloodshed of Jezreel on the house of Jehu or Judah, and bring an end to the kingdom of the northern house of Israel." The name Jezreel means Yahuwah shall scatter, or Yahuwah will sow, as wheat is sown into the ground. This is the concept to which Yahushua refers in his many agricultural parables. But notice, Yahuwah did not say he would destroy the Ephraimites themselves, only that he would bring an end to their kingdom, which will we will also see references to this in the new renewed covenant. And she conceived again and bore a daughter. Then Elohim said to him, call her name Lo Ruhama, for I will no longer have mercy on the house of Israel. Lo means no, but I will utterly take them away. The name Lo Ruhama means no mercy or no compassion. Yahuwah was implying that he was finished with the adulterous wife. He was going to scatter Ephraim into the ground like wheat seed or Jezreel, and would no longer have compassion or Ruhama on her because she refused to relent. Next, Yahuwah says that Ephraim will no longer be his people. Instead, they will become not his people, Lo Ami, not my people, Lo Ami. Now, when she had weaned Lo Ruhama, she conceived and bare another son. Then Elohim said, call his name Lo Ami, for you are not my people, and I will not be your Elohim. Hosea 1:8-9. And yet, despite all the terrible idolatry the house of Ephraim had committed against him, Yahuwah still promised to redeem them. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or counted, and it shall be in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people. There it shall be said to them, you are sons of the living Elohim. If Ephraim refused to keep the Torah, it would be like a repeat of the Garden of Eden. Yahuwah would kick Ephraim out of his special land and then draw the sword out after her until she repented. Many generations later, after she repented, Yahuwah would bring her descendants back to his land and reunite them with their Jewish brothers. Then the children of Yehuda and the children of Israel shall be gathered together and appoint for themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great is the day of Jezreel. Hosea 1:10-11. This happy reunion, however, would not take place for another 2,700 years. In the meantime, the Torah specifies that before judgment can be enacted against a sinner, there must be two or more witnesses to the sin. Therefore, in addition to Hosea, Yahuwah also sent a prophet named Eliyahu to witness against the house of Israel or Ephraim. Many Christians are familiar with Eliyahu's famous showdown with the priest of Baal. Few of them, however, realize how the names have been tampered with in almost all of the Western translations. This is a very good reason why we ask you guys to get a Hallelujah Scriptures Restored Name Translation or an Et Sefer. Let's see, what else is there? There is... Which one? The Aleph Tav Scriptures. We showed this on our live stream last night, but the Messianic Aleph Tav Scriptures by William Sanford. There's a Restoration Scriptures True Name Edition. There's even a Restored Name King James Version that's free online. There's the ISR, which stands for Institute for Scripture Research out of South Africa, and you can view that one online for free at www.biblehub. Just choose ISR. Okay, so few of them, however, realize how the names have been tampered with. The names have been tampered with. The names have been tampered with in almost all of the Western translations. In Scripture, names are always prophetic. In addition, if we think about it, we ought to be able to see how, in a word-created world, the sounds of words would have specific meanings. And indeed, as will be shown in Nazarene Scripture commentary, the sounds of words contain important spiritual information, which modern physicists and string theorists are only just beginning to understand. Pause and think of that. What they have learned is that specific resonances carry spiritual information, much like DNA carries genetic information. I would love to read more on that. However, for our purposes here, let us consider that if names are always prophetic, and if the world was created through sound or energetic resonance, and if the sounds of words have spiritual significance, then how important would the name of our Creator be? Most Christians are unaware of the fact that the Creator's true name, Yahuwah, has been hidden or substituted almost 7,000 times in Scripture. This is strictly against the third commandment, which tells us, "You shall not take the name of Yahuwah your Elohim in vain, for Yahuwah will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain." Although the classic English translation is not to take his name in vain, in the Hebrew, the word vain is actually Strong's H7723 Leshawa. This word does not translate into English directly, but the real meaning of this passage is actually somewhat more akin to, "You shall not desolate the name of Yahuwah your Elohim, for Yahuwah will not hold him guiltless who desolates his name." I understand it to mean to bring his name to vain emptiness. So this is Shemot, which means names. That's the real name of the book, names, or Shemot. We know it is Exodus 20, verse 7. If we study out the root of the word Lashawa, we see that in addition to not taking his name in vain, the commandment is not to desolate, not to cover over, not to disguise, not to substitute for, and not in any other manner hide his name. This is literally as simple and repeatable as getting your Strong's Concordance or an etymological dictionary, and looking up this word Shawa, and you can see these definitions there. It's repeatable. While we certainly must be careful not to take his name in vain, Yahuwah tells us in many places that he wants his true name made known in all the earth. And indeed, for this purpose, I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Okay, so here we have it. I want you to just like really realize this. We have a pairing of the power of Yahuwah inside us and his name. Okay, let's read the verse again. "And indeed, for this purpose, I have raised you up." For what purpose? He's raised us up for what purpose? "That I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth." So the power of Yahuwah in us and his name being declared in all the earth seem to be tied together to me there. There are many places in Scripture where Yahuwah poetically emphasizes the incredible importance of loving him and knowing his true name. Okay, so I want to bring up what Jonathan and I call sound bites. Whenever you hear somebody say, "Oh, those sacred namers, oh, those are sacred namer people," that is some sort of a little technique of the enemy. We call it a sound bite, where somehow that's supposed to keep you from searching out the truth of what the word says. It keeps you from reading the word and studying the word. So don't let anything keep you from studying the word. Just study the word and see what he says. And I recommend you do it in a restored name word, or you're not even going to understand what it says. You understand it very simply in a word that has had his name was taken out almost 7,000 times in the Tanakh, what we know as the Old Testament alone. And when you put it back in, then these meanings of these verses are very, very clear.
What it really comes down to is those that accuse people of being a sacred namer. Think about this. Is that the side of the argument you want to be on Judgment Day? That if you accuse people of wanting to declare his true name. Think about that if you're in a court appearance, folks. The logic in that. To a degree, it is a sacred name movement. His name is Kadosh. His name is holy. We're supposed to proclaim it. We're supposed to exalt it. There's power in his name, not titles of his being or his characteristic. These are things we need to understand, the semantics of these words.
Just be aware also of anything that you hear, and you hear people repeating it, like let your ears perk up a little bit. When you hear somebody repeating something and somehow...
He knows my heart.
Yeah, he knows my heart. Any little thing like there, you start hearing it over and over and over. That's a tactic of the enemy. Somehow he's got like some resonance in that so that it gets like a radio signal. It gets transmitted to repeater station to repeater station to repeater station. That is a tactic of the enemy. And the other thing to know these characteristic sound bites is it keeps the people that say it from examining the truth of the matter. Because Yahuwah says we're not to bring his name to vain emptiness in the Ten Commandments. He says to proclaim his name. He says to call upon his name. He says to declare his name. He says he blesses those who have known his name.
How about in Psalm 91? The very chapter people want to declare a covering over. What does it say in around verse 14? He heard him because he knew my name.
So there are many today who will know his name, and there are many today who won't know his name. So there again, we have to start looking at the fruit. Which ones are doing by the Spirit what his word says they're going to do? Because he says his word will not return to him void. His word goes out from him and accomplishes what he sent it to do. Okay, there are many places in Scripture where Yahuwah poetically emphasizes the incredible importance of loving him and knowing his true name. Because this is Psalm 91, 14 to 16 that Jonathan was just mentioning. We're going to read it again. So get ready. Here it comes. Before he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He will call upon me and I will answer him.
Hallelujah.
I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. I will satisfy him with long life and show him my salvation. And that word salvation is Yeshua.
Yeshua.
Psalm 91, 14 to 16. Since Yahuwah repeatedly tells us how much he wants people to know his true name, it is surprising how few people know his name is not Lord. In fact, the name Lord actually translates as Baal. Some Christians are shocked to learn that when they call on the name of the Lord, they are actually calling upon the name of the pagan deity Baal. Christians find this fact very confusing because they have received so many blessings by calling upon the name of the Lord in the past. However, without condemnation or judgment, once we have learned that the name Lord translates to Baal, both in ancient and modern Hebrew, then why not?
Go ask a modern Jew to say Lord in Hebrew, okay? And then ask him what the meaning of Jesus or Jesus, because there's no J in Hebrew, folks. Go ask a modern Jew what the word Jesus means. It means a horse. The name does not translate over to English.
So why not use Yahuwah's true name? If names are not important, and if it is okay to call Yahuwah by the names of other deities such as Baal, then why not simply call him Satan? Names are important. I don't see that he's written this anywhere here, but since we've already mentioned it, it's not a secret here. God, in your Strong's Concordance, H1408 and H1409, is Fortune, the Babylonian deity. That's his name.
Gimel Dal.
Yes, the letters are Gimel Dalas, like our G and our D. It's God. It's not Gad. It's God. It's in Isaiah 65:11. Yahuwah comes against the worship of this deity. It's just as simple as that.
And it is on the back of all of your dollar bills. In God we trust, folks. It's a Babylonian deity of fortune. Think about it. All the Illuminati symbolism there. You have been deceived and brainwashed. And you don't even know it. So you need to wake up. And that's the whole reason behind reading this book and getting this information out. You need to understand that.
I got to tell you, one time I had my Strong's Concordance and I had my Restored Name Scriptures, and I decided to take it upon myself for a day. I had a day to study, and I love to study, and I looked up everything Yahuwah had to say about his name. Wherever he said my name this or my name that, I looked up all those verses and I read all those verses, studied through them. I didn't get done in 8 hours all he had to say about his name. I mean, it was just overwhelming how important his name is to him.
Absolutely. And Christians that go and try to proselytize Jews as if it's an end-time ministry, they will never follow a person named Jesus for the simple reason what I just told you. That word in Hebrew means a horse. The person they need to be following is Yeshua, or his restored name, we believe, but the two Vav is Yahushua. That is the name.
That is the name.
The name Jesus didn't even exist until 500 years ago, folks. Think about that. The enemy is very cunning. We're talking about Satan, the one who's fallen, who is tricked. He's very cunning in twisting and turning things around. Think about it.
Yeah, I saw a post on Facebook today, and it was one of these images, and it talked about how the three times that Yahushua dealt with the enemy's temptations, he was quoting the Torah. That's how he dealt with him.
It is written. It is written. It is written.
He believed in the Torah. He lived the Torah. He loved the Torah. He ate the Torah. It was his bread.
Absolutely.
Maaseh, or Acts 17:30. Truly, these times of ignorance Elohim overlooked. But now, he commands all men everywhere to repent. That Christians do not intend to sin by calling upon the name of Baal, and that Yahuwah has overlooked their transgression in the past, is not a good reason to continue breaking the third commandment.
My people die because of lack of knowledge, folks.
Not a good idea. Not a good reason to continue breaking the third commandment. Once we know Yahuwah's true name, we should use it. For as we will see, Yahuwah does not hold him guiltless who call him Lord or Baal. I'll tell you right now, the best place I know to go learn about the name of Yahuwah and the name of his son is a guy named Messenger of the Name. His name is Mark Manning, Messenger of the Name on YouTube. He does a video called Restoring the Creator's Name, Hashem Revealed, and he does a video, What is His Son's Name? There's more research that man has done than anybody else I have ever seen.
So, for his age, and he's a young man.
Yes, he's a very young man.
Yeah.
And he's one of us. He's American. He's Yosef.
He's Ephraim. Yes. He's definitely Ephraim. And a shout out to him, by the way, if he's watching this video.
Once we know Yahuwah's true name, we should use it, for as we will see, Yahuwah does not hold them guiltless who call him Lord or Baal. He says we're to call on his name. That's what the Ten Commandments say, that we cannot make his name vain emptiness. Then it happened when Ahab saw Eliyahu, or Elijah as we know him, that Ahab said to him, Is that you, O troubler of Israel? See, the prophets were called troublers many, many times. Nobody liked the prophets, not the king, certainly. And he answered, I have not troubled Israel, but you and your fathers, Jeroboam's house, have, in that you have forsaken the commands of Yahuwah and have followed the Baals, or the lords, Melechim Aleph, or 1 Kings 18:17-18. Genesis 1 tells us that living beings pattern themselves after their parents, and Eliyahu is here rebuking Ahab for encouraging Israel to continue in the false practices of his father, King Jeroboam. Now, therefore, send and gather all Israel to me on Mount Carmel, the 450 prophets of Baal the Lord. Can you count how many prophets we have today for Baal the Lord? How many you think we have speaking in the name of the Lord? And the 400 prophets of Asherah, or Easter. How many prophets and teachers we got that teach Easter? Who eat at Jezebel's table. They're eating at Jezebel's table. Melechim Aleph, 1 Kings 18:19. Since most Christians never learn Hebrew. By the way, did you know in the book of Jubilees, I think it's chapter 12, Abraham in the winter, his name was Abram at the time, he learned Hebrew. He learned the ancient Hebrew. After the Tower of Babel incident, Abram was taught the ancient Hebrew by Yahuwah himself. Since most Christians never learn Hebrew, most of them never learn that the name Lord means Baal. They are also typically ignorant of the fact that the name Asherah means Easter. We've also heard Ashtoreth. However, most of those that do learn the difference usually still hop between two opinions, calling him both Yahuwah and Lord, or Yahuwah and God. I don't know. I don't get it. I don't get, once you know the truth, I believe you should be walking in the truth. I think you're accountable to walk in the truth. Once you know it, you do it. Like Yahushua said, you know it, you do it. The wise know it and they do it. It's like they built their house upon a rock instead of a house upon the sand, right? They know it and they do it. And because they know it, they never send somebody towards a falseness. Please don't do that. If you know the truth, please stand in the truth. You know, because you don't want to be accountable for leading somebody wrong because you want them to see some other truth. Okay? It's all truth. All the truth. We have to share all the truth, not just a piece of the truth. However, most of those that do learn the difference usually still hop between two opinions, calling him both Yahuwah and Lord in an attempt to simultaneously please him and man. So, and just remember, you know, I'm not getting on anybody. I know the wiles of this enemy, deceptive one that we deal with. And he tries to deceive. And he's like, you know what? You could call him Yahuwah to these people, and you could call him Lord or God to those people over there, because then they will listen to you. If you call him Lord and God, then you'll be like one of them, and then they can accept you and hear you and listen to you. Because we can say, you know what? We all knew him as Lord and God, but now it's been revealed to us. His name is Yahuwah. Let me show you in your King James translation in the foreword where it says that the translators took his name out of consideration of a tradition of the Jews. We can do that. We can show them where Messenger of the Names videos are. We can share truth. When we come into it, we're accountable. I believe we're accountable. I maintain that. That's what's in my heart. That's what I hear. So Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. And Eliyahu, or Elijah, came to all the people and said, how long will you keep hopping between two opinions? If Yahuwah is Elohim, follow him. But if the Lord, then follow him. But the people answered him not a word. 1 Kings 18:20-21. People are creatures of habit. Okay, I agree. They are. I see it. Once they get comfortable with a certain name, they do not like to change, be they right, wrong, or indifferent. They just, you know, they're creatures of habit. They get comfortable and they like to stay there and they don't want to get out of their comfort zone and they don't want to stand out as odd to anybody else, or they want to share some piece of truth that they think is important, but they don't want to share this truth because maybe they don't understand it's so important. I got to tell you, the name of Yahuwah is the key. If Yahuwah can trust you with his name and that you're going to stop, you're going to repent of calling on those other deities, you're not going to call on them anymore, he can trust you with other things. But you have to show him that you're going to walk in the truth. You're going to choose the truth. People are creatures of habit. We already read that one. Once told that the name Lord means Baal, many today similarly answer not a word. Perhaps they are not really sure which name is correct or if it really makes any difference. But as we will see here, it does. And we're going to say the same goes for God, the Babylonian deity of fortune. I'm telling you, you can look it up in your Strong's Concordance. It is repeatable. You will get the same result every time. You look up H1408, H1409, and you look up Isaiah 65:11, you will find Yahuwah saying, you have set a table for God. Regardless of what your King James translates it, you just get your little interlinear scriptures and you will see it says God. unto God, Babylonian deity of fortune. Then Eliyahu said to the people, I alone am left a prophet of Yahuwah. Are you going to be the one left alone, the prophet of Yahuwah, with the 400 prophets of Baal or God? Are you going to be the one against the 400? You tell me. I alone am left a prophet of Yahuwah, but the Lord's prophets are 450 men. Therefore, let them give us two bulls, and let them choose one bull for themselves, cut it in pieces, and lay it on the wood, but put no fire under it. And I will prepare the other bull, and lay it on the wood, but put no fire under it. Then you call in the name of your deities. Your deities. I don't use the word God here. You see the word God here? I don't use it. There is no big G and little g in Hebrew, okay? This should be the word Elohim. That's the word in the scriptures. It's Elohim. We've accepted this Babylonian deity's fortune as a common word. It's like talking about a jacuzzi for all hot tubs, okay? We take all deities and we say they're gods. And so we give this deity God a place in all the writings, okay? That's what the translators did. And so that's what we learned. And so, of course, we're creatures of habit, so we're just going to say gods. But there is no big G and little g in Hebrew, okay? It's just Gimel Dalet. There's no O, there's no S. It's Elohim, okay? It's Elohim. And I will call on the name of Yahuwah, and the Elohim who answers, here it is right. The Elohim who answers by fire, whether it's Yahuwah or it's Baal, he is Elohim. He's the real one. Whoever answers by fire, he's going to be the real one, okay? So all the people answered and said, it is well spoken. They agreed. 1 Kings 18:22-24. The people have agreed to the showdown. It's a showdown of Elohim, okay? The time's going to come when we're going to have a showdown of Elohim too. Which side are you going to be on? Are you going to be on Yahuwah's side, or are you going to be on Baal, who's the Lord, the Lord's side? You have to decide, because the real word, you know, the real word, not the translations, not they changed the translation this year from that year, and I'm thinking some crazy's going on. I can't even remember the stupid thing, what they call it. But you got to decide which side you're going to be on. I'll tell you, the real scriptures say Yahuwah. Now Eliyahu said to the prophets of the Lord, choose one bull for yourselves and prepare it first, for you are many, and call on the name of your Elohim, but put no fire under it. See, here now he's got the word Elohim, and that's amazing and awesome and wonderful. So they took the bull which was given them, and they prepared it and called on the name of the Lord from morning even till noon, saying, O Lord, hear us. They're praying, O Lord. But there was no voice. No one answered. Then they leaped about the altar which they had made. Yahuwah winks at times of ignorance, but once we learn the truth, we must obey it. I'm not talking to those of you that, I mean, I am talking to you, but those of you who know the name of Yahuwah, please walk in the truth of it. If you haven't researched it, but you've heard it, I know, if you're watching this channel, you've heard it. You are responsible to go search out the matter. I believe it with all my heart. You're responsible to go search out the matter and then walk in it. Don't keep coming and saying, oh, Gimel Dalet this and Gimel Dalet that. Okay? Yahuwah winks at times of ignorance, but once we learn the truth, we must obey it, unless we want to be mocked in the day of judgment. Get this right. It's going to be you and Yahuwah, you know? You got to get it right. You got to put all other men and all other opinions and all comfort levels and what you've always learned, you got to put it all behind you and just search out the truth and do it. We all have to do that. Everybody has to go through and re-examine what they were taught and make sure it was true, because Jeremiah 16:19-21 says, surely, it says, O Yahuwah, my strength and my stronghold in the day of trouble, in the day of distress, the Gentiles will come to you and say, surely our fathers inherited only falsehood and futility, in which there is no, one of the translations says vanity, in which there is no value in it. Shall a man make mighty ones or Elohim where there are no Elohim? And he says, and I will show them. I will show them my name. I will show them my might. And this time they will know my name is Yahuwah. My name, my might. And so it was at noon that Eliyahu mocked them and said, "Cry aloud, for he is a mighty one." See here how it says a gimel dalet, a god. This shouldn't be here. We can say a deity. We can say a mighty one, a deity. We can say Elohim. Why not say Elohim? It's not like nobody's heard it before, right? So that's, people come out of stuff at different times, and the author is partially out on this, and he, we need to pray that he keeps coming out on that, but we're so blessed that he's let us read his book. But really this should say, "Cry aloud, for he is a mighty one," or an El, okay, a deity. We don't want to use God as a generic, because that's still, it's a soundbite. It is the language of creation, the Hebrew. Let me tell you about a word. God, first of all, is the Babylonian deity of fortune. That's his name in Hebrew, okay? That's, God means fortune in Hebrew, and it's a Babylonian deity. The word good in Hebrew, we use it all the time in English, right? As a country, as people, we use it every day, all day long. Oh, how are you? Oh, I'm good, right? Good, that soundbite in Hebrew, it means to fall upon, to attack, for the purpose of taking what belongs to another. In essence, their goods are what they have that they stand to lose when someone comes and attacks them and takes it from them. That's what goods are, okay? When your government talks to you about what your goods are, well, be wary. Either he is meditating, or he is busy, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is sleeping and must be awakened. So he's mocking them, right? So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom, with knives and lances, until the blood gushed out of them. Okay, so this deity, the Lord, the Baal, that's how they worshipped him. That, you know, they're cutting themselves, was their custom, with knives and lances, until the blood gushed out on them. Like, they're basically like slaying themselves over here for this deity to do something. And when midday was past, they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. But there was no voice, no one answered, no one paid attention. Yahuwah gave the Ephraimite priest plenty of time to admit they were wrong. Then Eliyahu said to all the people, "Come near to me." So all the people came near to him. And he repaired the altar of Yahuwah that was broken down. And Eliyahu, or who we know as Elijah, took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of Yahuwah had come, saying, "Israel shall be your name," or Yashareel. Then with the stones he built an altar in the name of Yahuwah, and he made a trench around the altar large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. Eliyahu made the trench large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. The seed represents the Israelites, who are divided up into 2 houses. And he put the wood in order, cut the bull in pieces, and laid it on the wood, and said, "Fill 4 water pots with water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood." Then he said, "Do it a second time." And they did it a second time. And he said, "Do it a third time." And they did it a third time. 1 Kings 18:33-34. Eliyahu poured a total of 12 jars of water. So the water ran all around the altar, and he also filled the trench with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Eliyahu the prophet came near and said, "Yahuwah, Elohim of Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yashareel, let it be known this day that you are Elohim in Yashareel, and I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, Yahuwah, hear me, that this people may know that you are Yahuwah, Elohim." Are you telling the people of Yahuwah? "That these people may know, hear me, Yahuwah, hear me, that this people may know that you are Yahuwah Elohim." Is that your goal? That the people of Yahuwah will know that he is Yahuwah Elohim? "And that you have turned their hearts back to you again." Oh, let's pray. Let's pray that the people of Yahuwah turn their hearts back to him. Yahuwah may wink at our ignorance, but when he is put to the test, he only answers by fire when we call upon his true name. Then the fire of Yahuwah fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust, and it licked up the water that was in the trench. Now when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, Yahuwah, he is Elohim! Yahuwah, he is Elohim! And Eliyahu said to them, Seize the prophets of the Lord. Do not let one of them escape. So they seized them, and Eliyahu brought them down to the brook Kishon and executed them there. 1 Kings 18:35-40. In answering Eliyahu by fire, Yahuwah showed the Ephraimites who was Elohim. However, since living beings are creatures of habit, the Ephraimites kept on calling him Lord. So after they saw that those 400 prophets of the Lord of Baal were killed, they kept calling him Lord. It is therefore not surprising that modern-day Christians should also call him Lord, as their Ephraimite forefathers did the same. Hosea 13:1, when Ephraim spoke, there was trembling. He was exalted in Israel, but he incurred guilt through the Lord, and he died. Breaking the third commandment is no small sin. It is the third commandment, and is listed in order of importance even before the Shabbat or the Sabbath. Israel is swallowed up. In the early 700s BCE, Yahuwah had the kings of Assyria make several incursions into the land of Israel. Around 722 BCE, or that's before the Common Era, the Ephraimites' capital city of Samaria fell, and the Assyrians then carried the Ephraimites out of the land and deposited them in the lands that now make up modern-day Syria and Iraq. In the ninth year of Hosea, the king of Assyria took Samaria, the capital of Ephraim, and carried Israel away to Assyria and placed them in Halah and by the Habor, the river of Gozan, and in the cities of the Medes. For so it was that the children of Israel had sinned against Yahuwah their Elohim, who had brought them up out of the land of Egypt. Okay, I had to stop momentarily, so I'm going to start again at verse 8. And had walked in the statutes of the nations whom Yahuwah had cast out from before the children of Israel, and of the kings of Israel which they had made. Also the children of Israel secretly did against Yahuwah their Elohim things that were not right. Okay, these are secret sins. Okay? And they built for themselves high places in all their cities, from watchtower to fortified city. Their secret sins were aware. Yahuwah was aware of them, okay? He's after a righteous, pure remnant. They set up for themselves sacred pillars and wooden images on every high hill and under every green tree. There they burned incense on all the high places, like the nations whom Yahuwah had carried away before them. And they did wicked things to provoke Yahuwah to anger. For they served idols of which Yahuwah had said to them, You shall not do this thing. Okay, so if there's anything in his word that he said, You shall not do this thing, that's a provocation. Basically here it's talking about idols, right? For they served idols, yeah. Yet Yahuwah testified against Israel and against Yehuda by all of his prophets, every seer, saying, Turn from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes according to all the law which I commanded your fathers and which I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. Okay? So Yahuwah sent, he's testifying against Israel, your forefathers, and Yehuda, Yehuda's forefathers, by all of his prophets, and every seer, and every person who has vision and has some understanding they've been given, who are saying, Turn from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes. And that they weren't put away. My son didn't come to free you from obedience. According to all the law, all the instruction, this word is more than likely, this word in the Hebrew is instruction. It's Torah, which is instruction. According to all my instruction, which I commanded your fathers and which I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. And all we have to do is look this verse up and we'll know if this word is law or if it's instruction or, you know, we can look it up in the Hebrew and know for sure. Nevertheless, they would not hear, but stiffen their necks, like the necks of their fathers, who did not believe in Yahuwah their Elohim. They did not obey him. You know, sometimes we'll have people that comment on the videos, and they'll be like, I didn't know. What do I do? And the others will be like, you know, can you prove that 12 tribes, that two houses theory in the scriptures? Or they'll say some sort of a chide or something that they don't believe. So they'll quote one verse instead of the whole rest of the scriptures, right? But others, they have the soft, sweet heart, and they turn and they repent. And they rejected his statutes and his covenant that he had made with their fathers and his testimonies which he had testified against them. They followed idols, became idolaters, and went after the nations who were all around them, concerning whom Yahuwah had charged them that they should not do like them. So they left all the commandments of Yahuwah their Elohim, made for themselves a molded image. Okay, they left all the commandments of Yahuwah their Elohim. Who else did that? Who left all the commandments of Yahuwah? Made for themselves a molded image and two calves, made a wooden image. Anybody know a wooden image in their religion? And worshipped all the host of heaven and served the Lord, or Baal. Melechim Bet, 2 Kings 17, 6-16. Verse 14 tells us that because the Ephraimites did not keep Yahuwah's commandments, they were like unto their fathers who did not believe in Yahuwah either. While their fathers may have believed in the Greco-Roman intellectual sense, they believed that way. They're like, okay, well, I know, you know, he died for me, so, you know, he must be the Savior. They had like a mental assent, right? Since they did not obey Yahuwah's commandments, Yahuwah tells us that they did not truly believe. Obedience is how we know that we believe the Messiah, and then we love him and his and the Father. We obey his commandments. We believe him. We love each other. The Assyrian policy was to assimilate newly conquered peoples by resettling them in other lands and bringing in others to replace them. Okay, so this is when the 10 northern tribes, when they got kicked out of Israel, the Assyrian policy is to assimilate them by resettling them in other lands, and then they learn to serve their deities, which is what Yahuwah said would happen when they got kicked out of the land. And then they bring in others to be there and to replace them, like, hey, that's our land, okay? It's our land, and we're supposed to go back and get it and reclaim it on the Jubilee year. But there's other people there. Therefore, when the Ephraimites were taken out of their land, Samaria, other peoples took their place. Then the king of Assyria brought people from Babylon, Cutha, Abba, Hamath, and from Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel. And they took possession of Samaria and dwelt in its cities. Melechim Bet, 2 Kings 17:24. The Assyrians took away all but a few of the poorest Ephraimites and then brought in other peoples to intermarry with them. Well, that was a no-no. In Yahuwah's word, that's a no-no. The result was a new half-breed race called the Samaritans. The Samaritans were a double hybrid. They were the seed of Ephraim, which was itself a mixture between Joseph and Asenath, and now they became mixed with still more peoples. Being a double hybrid, the Samaritans were wont to keep all sorts of practices that are not found anywhere in Torah. Some of the Samaritan practices were very strange, and so Yahuwah sent lions to attack the people. Realizing that the Elohim of the land, Yahuwah, was upset, the king of Assyria had one of the Ephraimite priests sent back into the land to teach the people the worship that Jeroboam originally concocted, not realizing that it was corrupt and that it was the reason for Ephraim's exile to begin with. Then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, send there one of the priests whom you brought from there. Let him go and dwell there, and let him teach them the rituals of the Elohim of the land. Then one of the priests whom they had carried away from Samaria came and dwelt in Bethel and taught them how they should fear or obey Yahuwah. Melchim bet, 2 Kings 17:27-28. Yahuwah did allow himself to be appeased, but verse 33 tells us that even though the Samaritans feared Yahuwah, they were still serving their own Elohim, exactly as the church would later do. They, the Samaritans, feared Yahuwah, but they were serving their own mighty ones as well, according to the ruling of the nations to whom they had been exiled. To this day, they are doing according to the former rulings. They are not truly fearing Yahuwah, nor did they truly follow their laws or their right rulings, which Yahuwah had commanded the children of Jacob, whose name he made Yashareel, or Israel. Melchim bet, 2 Kings 17:33-34. Since these departures from the Torah basically amount to apostasy, the Jews generally avoided the Samaritans. This is why the woman at the well was so astonished that Yahushua would even speak to her. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Yohanan, or John 4:9. We will read more about the woman at the well in future chapters, but at the moment we need to know that while the Assyrians encouraged the Samaritan immigrants to learn Jeroboam's worship, the converse was also true. The Assyrians encouraged the Ephraimites to adopt the religious practices of the lands to which they had been scattered, and perhaps not wanting to suffer persecution or discrimination, they did so. None of this escaped the attention of the Ephraimites' Jewish brothers. When Israel was carried away for practicing false worship, the Jewish sages recorded their impressions of what had transpired in an important historical document called the Talmud. A Talmud tractate, Yebamot 17a, the Jewish sages recorded that once the Ephraimites had been deposited in their new Assyrian lands, they had begun fathering what the sages called strange children. The Jews called these strange children strange because they no longer kept the Torah or spoke Hebrew. So the children that are not taught Torah or to speak Hebrew would be regarded as strange children. Since the Ephraimites were no longer living in the land of Israel, no longer spoke Hebrew, and no longer kept the covenant, the Jewish sages ruled that Ephraim's children were no longer worthy to be called Israelites. That's a very important statement there. Let's read it again. Since the Ephraimites were no longer living in the land of Israel, no longer spoke Hebrew, and no longer kept the everlasting covenant, the Jewish sages ruled that Ephraim's children were no longer worthy to be called Israelites. The sages ruled that since they were indistinguishable from the Gentiles, they were legally classed as Gentiles and that they should be thought of as Gentiles. Since the Jews considered the rulings of the sages to be inspired, they also believed these rulings to carry the weight of law. For this reason, the Ephraimites were now officially thought of as Gentiles from the time of their dispersion right on up through the first century when the new or the renewed covenant was written. Scripture only concerns itself with Israel or Yashareel. It does not concern itself with the other nations of the world, except insofar as they form the backdrop of events happening to the nation of Yashareel. Therefore, we can surmise that the references to the Gentiles of the renewed covenant are actually references to the Gentile children of the lost 10 tribes of Yashareel. As Ephraim rapidly assimilated into the Assyrian national culture, the tribal genealogies that had always been so highly valued were soon lost. This had to happen in order to fulfill Hosea 8:8. Israel is swallowed up. Now they are among the Gentiles like a vessel in which is no pleasure. Hosea 8:8. When you swallow something, it soon becomes impossible to tell the difference between the food you swallowed yesterday and you. This was fast becoming the case with the children of Ephraim, who were being assimilated into the Assyrian Empire. The Jewish sages knew from the Torah that the lost 10 tribes would have to be scattered to the ends of the earth in order to fulfill the promises given to the patriarchs. What they could not understand, however, was how the lost 10 tribes would ever be brought back to the land when their genealogies were so rapidly and so completely disappearing. The classical definition of a Messiah is that of a divinely appointed leader who brings the lost and the scattered of Israel back to the land. Okay?
The sheep know his name, know his voice.
Classical definition of a Messiah, okay, again, is divinely appointed leader who brings the lost and the scattered Israel back to the land and to the eternal covenant. But how could any human being ever bring the children of Ephraim back to the land when their genealogies were being erased? How would anyone ever bring the children of Ephraim back to the land and to the eternal Torah? When no one could any longer tell who they were. Okay, that's it for our reading, and we've gone just a little over 2 hours, and we'll pick up on our next reading at the chapter that is establishing the pattern. Thank you for being here. Yahuwah watch over you and give you confirmations in your spirit as to the truth of the matter, and please do the research of what you learn. Please don't settle for everything you've always known. Just go for the truth. Go for the pure truth. Shalom.